an essay that I wrote about 3 years ago, and it was titled, On Becoming the Elder Generation, an Essay on Maturing, Part 1. So this kind of indicated, when I saw it, that I'm supposed to be continually writing. There's Part 2, and who knows how many other parts to write yet, but I've only gotten Part 1 so far. And what prompted this essay was the death of my mother 3 months earlier, and also some conversations that I had with my mom's oldest surviving sister, my aunt. There are three aunts of mine that are surviving from my mother's family at this point. And it is only those three women that separate my generation from becoming the eldest generation. And I'm sure all of you have had to think about this at some point. You may be the eldest generation, you may be on the verge of becoming the eldest generation, or you may be a generation that, what do you mean I'm going to get old? That's you guys. It's so serious.
Oh, me too.
Well, in my discussion with my eldest aunt, she made a comment that she did not want to be the last one surviving in her generation. In her mind, should her two surviving sisters pass on before her, she will be all alone. Now, she has three daughters that live close to her and are more involved in her life than what she would actually like them to be. She'd like a little more space, but these cousins of mine are looking in on their mom all the time. And so I began to wonder, why would she have this sense of feeling alone, having three daughters around her? Well, it kind of reminded me of the same sense of aloneness that my mother had spoken about previously when the woman who had raised her had developed Alzheimer's. And there was a point in that relationship where my great aunt no longer recognized my mother. And it was extremely devastating to my mom, because my mom's comment was, I feel like my past has been erased. And I had a very hard time understanding what she meant by that. So we had some more conversation. And I said, well, you know, even though Aunt Bobby does not remember who you are, you still have those memories. Yes, that's true, she said. But I don't have her to where I can remember my childhood. I no longer have that person who experienced my childhood to where I can bounce off my memories. This is one of the truths about growing older and moving into what is known as that senior position in the family. So what do we do when we find ourselves in this situation? How do we survive the changes in status? Who do we share our memories with? For my mother, even though she was one of eight children, she had actually been raised as an only child. Not uncommon during the Depression. Large families couldn't always afford to maintain everything, so once in a while you would ship a child over to a relative who maybe did not have any children. For my aunt, even though she has four children of her own, of which she has memories of them growing up and so forth, once her two sisters pass away, she has nobody to share her childhood memories with. Well, this morning I want us to focus on growing through change. Just because we know that change is inevitable, it doesn't necessarily make it easier to accept it. In this morning's text, we find Jeremiah speaking to a people who had been carried from their homeland to a land far away. And in this story, the southern kingdom, Israel, being carried off to a land by their captors, the Babylonians, a land that was different in language, the land was peculiar, the citizens, the way that they lived, it was a peculiar way of living. There's just a whole different way of understanding life. Even their gods were unfamiliar to them. So how does one survive when life is totally disrupted? In Psalms 137, the question was asked, how can we sing the songs of Zion? How can we sing the songs of praise when change feels like being carried off into a foreign land, where every aspect of life is so totally different than what one grows up learning and understanding? Within this particular reading, Jeremiah tries to address those questions as a way of giving comfort to those in the midst of change, and also as a way of giving hope toward a better future. While I was living in Rock Springs, Wyoming, I had the privilege of meeting a couple of friends who were a Jewish couple. The wife, Liesel, came to this country at the age of 12 as a refugee from Germany, simply because she was born a Jewess. One evening at dinner, Liesel wanted to show off this quilt that had been made by a friend, made out of pillow slips that had been Liesel's mother's trousseau. Arthur Caruso. So it was a great quilt, and it holds tremendous stories in that quilt. So Liesel's story of her family coming to America is a story that closely reflects what Jeremiah is writing about this morning. Their first home in the United States was in New York City, in Harlem. Not only were they foreigners in a new land, not understanding the language very well, but they were also one of the few white folks living in the neighborhood. And on top of that, they were Jewish. Even in 1940, being Jewish in the United States was not a very popular thing. Just like their ancestors, they found themselves having to cope in a land that was totally foreign to them. At one point, Liesel's mother made a comment to her father, to the husband, and for this, we left Germany. Life was rough. They were alone. How do we cope with dramatic changes in our lives? Jeremiah was speaking to those who physically had been carried off to a foreign land, yet there are differing empires, differing Babylons within our lives that makes today's lectionary extremely personable. Empires with names like fear, materialism, consumerism, violence in the home, mental illness, shrinking church attendance. And just being alone, isolation, are just a few of those names. There are times in our lives when changing circumstances dictate our having to leave what is familiar to us and plunges us into these crossroads of the unknown. There are all sorts of events in our lives that demand a change in what we are used to experiencing. There are changes in our lives that we bring through our own actions, and there are changes that can occur through the actions of others. We as a faith community are finding ourselves in the midst of change on two fronts. One is the absence of a settled pastor. The other focuses on what do we do next? Fear, uncertainty, confusion and anger are just but a few of the emotions that occur when life of a congregation goes through these kinds of upheavals. When we find ourselves in the midst of major change, the question of How often do we have to put up with these uncertainties? It's certainly at the top of the list. As a faith community, questions like, how long before we get our next pastor? What are we going to look for in our next pastor? Why do we need to have so many congregational discussions about what to do next? Why should we be reading extra material or attending Crossroad book studies? This is a commercial. What behavioral changes must we make as a faith community in order to move forward in our ministry? Are just a few of those honest questions that we're all asking in one form or another. Change often seems painful in the process, but when seen as an opportunity to examine the positives and the negatives, the end result will be a stronger and more productive community. When God was telling the Israelites, who had been carted off to Babylon to build houses and settle down, plant gardens, marry, have sons and daughters, and have your sons and daughters marry, and live and become prosperous, because if the community is prosperous, they too will prosper. God was saying, do not just sit and complain and moan about the bad things and how bad they are. Or by converting comforting yourselves with those memories of the past. Don't just sit around moaning and groaning and saying, gosh, I remember when. But get in and make the most of it. Look to the future. In other words, become the solution. In my essay on becoming the elder generation, I hear God telling me that the future of my tribe, my family, lies in how I choose to face that next chapter in my life. As the senior member of this faith community, our responsibility is to look for and continue to build upon the opportunities that will help our younger generations to prosper in the mission of this church. As we take stock of our strengths and plan our future, let us continue in prayer to thank God for the unseen new opportunities. For it is through God's guidance and our openness to grab hold of the future that prosperity will occur. Change comes to us whether we want it to or not. But the secret to successfully prosper through change is to trust that God is in the midst of all of the confusion and opportunities and of the uncertainties. Change provides opportunity for spiritual growth if we trust God enough to openly and honestly explore the possibilities. It is in our prayers for Babylon, which I think was rather interesting, praying for Babylon, praying for our captors, praying for those changes that are occurring in our lives. It is in our prayers for Babylon that we find our voice to sing the songs of Zion.
Amen. Amen.